All right, family, how are we tonight? Hope our family's doing good. Thank God for blessing us, guiding us, giving us another great day to be alive and to represent Him. We love God. We love church. We love the people of God. We love the kingdom of God and the body of Christ. And we are excited once again to engage in worship and praise, to engage in spirit with the Lord, knowing that God told us that we are spirit, that He is spirit, we are spirit, and we worship Him in spirit and in truth. So I want you to just get in your spirit and allow the Spirit of God in you, allow the grace of God on the inside of you to just come alive and to be strong now. Let's pour into Him with all the strength that we have. I know we've had long days. I know some have had long seasons. For some, it's been a long year. But one thing we know, God has been good every single day. God has been great. God has been active. God is busy on your behalf and on my behalf. And so on this Wednesday night, our Bible study night, are faithfully, intentionally training. We are getting fit, F-I-T, in the Lord. We're getting fit spiritually. And we know this is our year that we want to see results. We want to see the results of God's activity, of God's word in our life. And so we are working towards that end. So right now, let's prepare now to sing. Let's prepare to worship. Let's prepare to go into the presence of the Lord, hear the word, and then apply that word to our life. So I want you to stand with me now on this Wednesday night. Stand with me if you can. And I want you to stand to just get your posture, your mindset, your heart ready so that this next hour and a half, that it is totally dedicated to me giving God what He deserves and receiving what He has for me tonight. Lord, we thank You and we honor You on this great Wednesday night that You have given us. You kept us alive for this moment and this time, and You set for us to study Your word tonight. You set for us to gather together to praise and worship. You, God, on Your calendar, by Your design, right now where we are in our different homes, God, right now where we stand in Your presence, desiring to give You our very best, because that is what You gave us, God, nothing less than Your very best. So I speak life to those who are online tonight, God. I send life, Your grace, Your power, Your strength, Your deliverance, Your restoration, Your healing, Your might, Your boldness, Your goodness, God. I send that to everyone right now, tuned in, and who is watching, who is attentive, who has postured themselves right now to give You glory and to give You honor. I thank You because You are a God that responds. God, not a hand clap, not a shout, not a praise, not a song goes wasted when we honor You, when we direct it to You, when we lift You up. And so we come now, God, asking always to forgive us of sin, wash us and cleanse us, God. Prepare us, Lord, so that when we give You honor, glory, praise, and worship, it is coming from a pure vessel so that we can receive everything You have for us tonight, God. I thank You and I speak strength right now into everyone who is online. Strength of God, strength and power of the Holy Spirit, God. I pray that You will quicken us, God. Renew us, God. Put Your life in us and stir it up so that once again we will not come out of tonight being the same. Our desire is to be more like You every single day. So Holy Spirit, use us to glorify and to magnify the greatness of the Lord as we use our lips and our voices tonight to give You honor, to give You glory, and to give You praise. Come on, clap your hands, family. Put the hands together that God gave you. Let praise go forth in your home. Let praise go forth in your room. Let praise go forth in your neighborhood and in your community. And you give God glory right where you stand. And let us sing our way into the presence of the Lord.
Hallelujah. Glory to the name of Jesus. Hallelujah. God, You're worthy. Come on, somebody clap your hands just because He's worthy tonight. song says, I just want to praise you forever and ever and ever. Thank you, Jesus, for blessing me. Hallelujah. It's been a long day, but I declare tonight that God is worthy of our best praise and our best worship. He's an awesome God. There's none like him. Hallelujah. So I purposed in my heart and in my mind to sing to the glory of God. Hallelujah. Bless you, Jesus. Come on, let's lift him tonight. Woo, you're worthy, God. Yes, Lord. You're worthy, Jesus. I honor you. Thank you, Lord. Oh, yeah, yeah. I just want to praise you. Lord. Woo! Thank you, God. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. You deserve it tonight, God. Oh, we worship you. Hallelujah. I exalt you, Father. Oh, I love you with all of my heart, oh God. All of my mind, Jesus. Belongs to you. Jesus. My hallelujah belongs to you. My hallelujah belongs to you. My hallelujah belongs. You deserve.
King of all, You are the Lord of all. You are God of all. We honor you this night. Give you intentional worship. Give you praise, honor, and glory. Belongs to you, God, and we love giving it to you. We love giving you worship. We love giving you praise. Thank you, God. Fill in our hearts. Fill in our hearts with your music, with your song. Ah, feel Jesus. You are the greatest, Lord. You are the greatest. We thank him again for our worship tonight. Thank him for allowing us to just be used by him. DeAndre, my wife, singing, playing before the Lord. Honored, just allowing all of us to pour ourselves into the presence of God on a Wednesday night to just get refueled and strengthened as we continue our journey to maturity. Amen. Yes. Amen. Let's jump right in to 2 Timothy, as that is the book we are walking in and we are walking through, book of 2 Timothy, and we are still in chapter number 2. We're still in chapter number 2 of 2 Timothy, Paul's letter to Timothy, again, as Paul is in a dungeon awaiting his death from Nero, who's the emperor during that time, Rome. He has sentenced Paul to die, and before Paul dies, he writes his son in the ministry, Timothy, who traveled with him, who is there pastoring a church in Ephesus. And Paul is giving him the instructions, giving him the tools, giving him what he needs to build accurately, to make sure that he raises up men and women, mature and strong, ready to be witnesses for Christ. And again, we just love the Holy Spirit and using Paul, as Paul wrote, as he was moved by the Holy Spirit, not of his own accord, not of his own opinion or mind, but Bible says that holy men, they wrote as the Holy Spirit gave them what to write, gave them what to think, put it in their personality and in who they were, but yet it was his word, God's word to us. And so we want to receive it as coming from the Lord into our lives tonight. Last week, we left off in verse number 10. We talked about that powerful, powerful, impactful verse that Paul wrote to Timothy when Paul said, I'm willing to endure anything if it will bring salvation and eternal glory in Christ Jesus to those who God has chosen. And that should have left an impression upon us, the fact that I should be willing to endure anything if it brings the message of salvation to others. We have to get to that level. If we're not there, we have to live on that level. Whatever I have to go through for somebody else to hear Jesus, to see Jesus, to experience him, that's where we have to live. That's where we have to function. That's where we as individuals have to operate. I'm willing to endure. And that's just the mindset that knows that when I'm going through, it's not about me. It is not about me. God is trying to reach other individuals, and all he needs is his church, his body. He needs those who call upon his name to be willing to be put anywhere, go through anything, so that he can use us to reach others. That's where we left in verse 10, and we pick up with verse 11. As we're kind of like in the middle of this particular chapter one of 2 Timothy, chapter 2 of 2 Timothy. We're like right in the middle of this chapter. And in verse 11, he says, this is a faithful saying, for if we died with him, we also live with him. This is a faithful saying, for if we died with him, we shall also live with him. And when Paul is writing this to Timothy, when he starts with that word, with those words, this is a faithful saying, he is making this a very, very powerful, significant, one of those stop type moments. And hear what I'm saying, Timothy. Stop right now. Pay attention to what I'm about to say. When he says that this is a faithful saying, what he is saying is this is a sure thing, what I'm about to write. It's not that anything else wasn't, but there's every now and then you want to put emphasis on something that is about to be spoken. And so here he's putting an emphasis, and he's saying that, what I'm about to say, this is a sure thing. What I'm about to say, he's saying, Timothy, you can stake your life on it. This is the truth. I want you to give full attention now to what I'm about to say. And Paul is about to make four particular statements that he wants Timothy to give full attention to. So he says, this is a faithful saying. Now, statement number one, Paul tells Timothy, for if we died with him, we shall also live with him. That's statement number one. For this is a faithful saying, Timothy, if we died with him, we shall also live with him. If we died with him refers to baptism, is what Paul is talking about. It's a repeated theme in many of his letters to the church. And when he says, if we died with him, he's referring to baptism, where Paul wrote back in Romans that we were buried with him in baptism. When we begin our journey with Christ, when we ask the Lord to come into our life and we thank him for forgiving us of our sins, and we began to walk with him, at that moment, at that point, we were buried with him in baptism, meaning this is not a physical death that Paul is telling Timothy about when he says, if we died with him. He's not talking about a physical death. He's talking about death to sin, death to the power of sin, death to the influence of sin, death to the strength of sin being upon my life and your life. When we united with Christ and begin our journey with him, Paul is saying for Timothy, this is a faithful saying, if we died with him, if we were buried with him in baptism, if we die to sin, the power of sin over our life, he says this, we shall also live with him. We shall live with him refers to our resurrection to a new life. We died to sin and we rose to a new life. For you and I, when we were baptized, and we believe in baptism by immersion, meaning going under the water, when we go down, that is a physical picture of what happens to our life when we come into the body of Christ, when we begin to walk with Christ. We die, we go down, we were buried. That's our burial from a physical picture. We were buried with him. And then when we come up out of the water, now we come up to a newness of life. That is the picture that we are seeing that God gave us in a natural sense. That's why it's important to be baptized, because this statement and this truth, this principle, this faithful saying, as Paul said, is very, very important for you and I to keep at the forefront of our heart and of our mind. The fact that I died with him and I rose with him the minute I began my relationship with Christ. I was buried with him in baptism, and I came up with him, resurrected to a newness of life. And this is what he's talking about. In Romans 6:2, he says this about this same passage. He says, how shall we who died to sin live any longer in it? Very powerful scripture. He said, how shall we who have died to sin, Paul told them in his letter to the Romans, how shall we who have died to sin live any longer in it, is what he wrote in the book of Romans to the believers. How shall we, again, who have died to sin, live any longer in sin? It's a picture of, when I think of this, of a snake shedding its skin. When a snake sheds its skin, what happens is he's taking off the old skin and he's starting continuing his life in a new skin. And that snake cannot go back and put that old skin on again and live in it. It's impossible. The snake, he finds the roughest surface that he can. He'll try to find a rock, something real sharp, and he'll begin to rub against it, and the dead skin begins to come off. And when that dead skin or that old skin comes off, that snake does not turn around and try to go back into that. He can't do it. It's impossible. That's the picture that I want you and I to see. And because when that snake sheds the skin, what triggers the snake to shed the skin is that the new skin outgrows the old skin. And if the snake did not grow, he would not shed skin. It's because of his growth that skin begins to come off. So you and I want us to see that picture and realize when that scripture says, how can we who are no longer dead to sin live in it? We cannot continue to live in it if we truly die to it. Because like the snake, I can't go back and continue to practice a sinful life that I once lived. And we found that out last week when we read about John, that when God's seed is in us, we cannot practice sin. So dead to sin means now, right now, today, as believers, if we sin, it is an intentional act that I chose to do. Yeah. Now it is. Before, if I sin, I really didn't have a choice because the Spirit of God was not in me. I was dead to God. I was doing my thing. I was practicing. I was living it. Had no conviction of what I was doing, just doing sin. Now that I have Christ, now that the power of sin is broken, now I have a choice. So if I sin, it's an intentional act. Because those of us, again, who are dead to sin, how can we live anymore? I can't just automatically do it. If I do it, it's because I choose to sin. It is a choice, an intentional choice that I make. Paul also said this in Romans. He said that it means this. Do not yield your members as instruments to unrighteousness. He says, don't do it. Don't yield your members. Again, if I sin, not only is it an intentional act, but I am yielding. You know when you're yielding to something. Yielding doesn't happen on accident. I know if I'm yielding. I just, yielding is a choice. And Paul tells us that in the book of Romans, do not yield your members as instruments unto unrighteousness. Don't do that. He said, because you have a choice to either walk upright or to walk wrong, to walk in obedience or to walk in disobedience. And he says here that when you yield your members as instruments unto unrighteousness, when I think of an instrument, I think that if I yield myself to the enemy, then I'm allowing him to play me however he wants to. When you think of a musical instrument, if I'm an instrument right now, I either can yield to the Holy Spirit, to God, or I can yield to the enemy. And if I yield to the enemy, then he can play me however he wants to. If I yield to God, he will use me however he wants to. And so we have to realize it is a choice. It is a choice that you and I make on a daily basis, because you and I who are saved, who have Christ in us, we have died to sin. And how can we live any longer in it? We if I do it, it's by choice. And if I don't, it's by choice. I need you and I need myself to make sure that we are choosing to walk upright. We're choosing to follow God every day. I'm choosing. This is my choice. Now, again, now we're talking mature believers. I choose to worship. I choose to pray. I choose to obey. I choose to read the word. It is my choice. These things don't happen on accident. You are an intentional believer. If you grow, it's intentionally because you chose to do the things that require growth and development and to be built up in him. And if I don't do those things, then I'm choosing, whether I want to say it or not, I'm choosing to be weak. I'm choosing to be yielded to the enemy. I'm choosing to stay on the same level. I'm choosing to be immature. And that is not you and I. Our goal is to make sure we wrap this faithful saying that if we die with Christ, then we shall also live with him. With him. Again, that's the difference between who you are now and who you used to be. Now, what you do is with him. That's the power, again, of this text. With him. If I live now with him. I just don't live. I live with him every day. Somebody put that in your chat, with him, with him. Get that in your heart. Get that in your spirit. When I wake up, I'm waking up with him. When I walk every day, I'm walking with him. When I live, I'm living with him. It's not just me. It's not just living. No, it is with him. When you put that in the category, it should change how you and I approach our day. It should change, right? Right now, I'm serving and I'm standing in my position with him. I don't do anything without him. I'm preaching with him. I'm teaching with him. You're listening with him. You're going to apply that word with him. Everything is not just you. It's not just me. It is with him. That's why we are who we are right now versus who we used to be. It was just me. Now who I am, it is with him, with him, with him. And so he says, statement number one, for if we die with him, we shall also live with him. And again, this statement speaks of our identification with his death and resurrection. The Lord wants us, he wants us to make sure we identify our identification with him, our ID card with him is based upon his death and resurrection, my death and my resurrection. We identify with him. Our identification with Jesus is death to sin and newness to life. Amen. That's our ID with him. Death to sin and newness to life. And it's a beautiful picture because you and I are both dead and alive at the same time. That's what we are. If he's telling us you died with him, we live with him, you and I walk every day, we're dead and alive at the same time. That's how we journey. That's how we walk. I'm dead and alive at the same time. I'm dead to sin and I'm alive to God. I'm dead to unforgiveness. I'm alive to forgiveness. I'm dead to sorrow. I'm dead to depression. I'm alive to joy. I'm alive to peace. I'm dead to confusion and darkness. I'm alive to peace and light. That is our journey, dead and alive at the same time. And we're able to accomplish this, Paul also said over in Romans, by the glory of the Father. And that word glory means by the power of God. That you and I are able to walk dead and alive every day at the same time by the power, by the ability of God who is on the inside of us. He gives us the juice. He gives us the strength to be dead and alive at the same time every single day. So that's statement number one. Statement two in verse number 12. Statement one, if we die with him, we shall live with him. He says statement number two is if we endure, we shall also reign with him. If we endure, we shall also reign with him. I'm gonna give you statement three since it's right there too. If we deny him, he also will deny us. So statement two is if we endure, we shall also reign with him. Statement three is if we deny him, he also will deny us. So let's look at statement two. If we endure, the word endure, the strength, the power of that word, it means to remain. Everybody shout where you are, remain, 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 remain. He says, if we endure, again, the picture is going through in a trial, in a battle, in chaos, in confusion, in COVID-19, in a dark time. If we endure in this time, if we what? Remain what? If we remain faithful, if we remain obedient, if we remain in peace, if we remain in joy, if we remain in our word, if we remain a worshiper, if we remain lovers of God, if we remain in him, if we remain like him, if we remain, that's what the word endure means. If I remain while I'm going through, if I remain and I don't let what's happening to me get on the inside of me and begin to break up the ability to remain. He said, no, you remain as you're going through, because if you remain, you will also reign with me. That means you will also triumph with me. You will experience triumph. You will experience victory. You will see it. It will be in your life. You will walk with it. You will know it. We will triumph with who? Him. Again, if we endure, and again, it is everything is with him. If we remain with him, and we're going through, we will triumph with him. Again, remain with him. We will triumph with him. And then he said, The first two were two positives. Dying and living is a positive. Enduring and reigning is a positive. And then he points out two negatives. He says on the first negative, and we read it, it said if we deny him, he will also deny us. That's statement number three. If we deny him, he will deny us. To deny him, it means to disassociate myself with him, to disconnect, to disown, to reject him. John Wesley, he said this, powerful commentator of the word, in his commentary, John Wesley said this, to deny him is to escape suffering for him. To deny him is to escape suffering for him. Very powerful, because there are certain trials that you and I will go through, have to go through, because of our relationship with Jesus. Jesus said in this life, you will have tribulation. You're gonna have trial. There's certain trials and tests. There's certain valley experiences that you and I have to go through solely based upon our relationship with Jesus, period. Because we're walking with him, there are some trials we will have to. They're already laid out because we are walking with him. There are going to be attacks that come from people because we are walking with him. There's going to be betrayal. There's going to be rejection because we are walking with him. There's going to be humiliation. There's going to be misunderstanding. Why? Because solely our relationship with Jesus. So to choose to not go through a trial that is associated with my relationship with Jesus, again, choose. To choose not to go through a trial because it is associated with my relationship with Jesus, if I choose not to go through, I just denied him. That's the power of that statement. If we deny him, that means if I choose not to go through something that is difficult because it came with my relationship with Christ, and I say, well, I'm not going through that, I just denied him as a denial of Jesus. It is like Peter, when he was around that you know, Jesus, and he got close to the time they arrested him, and they were scourging him, and they had just took Jesus, and Peter standing nearby, and some of them saw him, and they said, "You're one of his." In other words, you followed him, you walked with him. We know you. You traveled with Jesus. You were singing with those other disciples, and Peter was the only one. The other disciples, they broke camp. But Peter was staying close enough. But when they looked at him and they recognized him, and one great thing happened here, and the other one not so great. The great thing that happened is that they recognized him as being a follower of Jesus. They recognize, and that's what you and I want. We have to live where people will recognize, wait a minute, you're one of his. They recognized him being associated with Jesus, and they wanted to do some harm to him. They said, well, since you're one of his, in their mind, they wanted to go ahead and pull him in and beat on him too. And when Peter saw that, you know, they did not like the fact that he was associated with Jesus, and they wanted to do some harm to him too, quickly, Peter denied Jesus. He denied being real, because Peter knew if I disassociate myself with him, I won't have to suffer. I won't have to go through. They'll leave me alone. If I disassociate myself with Jesus, they'll back up off of me. They won't talk to me. And Peter did this, and he did it stern, very sternly. He used some of them words that, you know, we used to use. You know, we don't use them no more. Them curse words we used to use. Peter, the Bible said that he stood very strong in his language, and he denied him based upon the fact that if I disassociate myself, if I deny him, then they won't mess with me. And that's something that you and I have to really, really, I want us to look and take inventory and investigate and scan our own lives and look at ourselves and ask the question, is there any area in my life where I denied Jesus because I was unwilling to suffer for him? Any area in my life where I denied him, where I disassociate, where I separate, because I knew if I stood, you know, kept my Jesus relationship, I was going to go through something. I was going to have to suffer something. So is there any area where I denied him in order not to go through? Well, if I did that, please hear me. If I chose not to go through because it was associated with my relationship with him, I just denied him. I just denied him. Is there anything or anyone in our life that I chose over Jesus? Because I didn't want to wait for who God had for me or what he had for me. And I chose this one over Jesus. Because why? I didn't want to have to suffer and wait. What I just did, I just denied him. And hear me, you and I would not willingly say, I'm going to deny Christ today. I'm going to deny. We don't say that. We won't come at it like that. But if I choose not to go through and suffer, if I choose not to go through suffer something that's based upon my relationship with him, then I just denied him. And you and I must be careful that we do not deny him. Do not deny him. Because if we deny him, what did he say? I'll deny you.
Yes.
The way I respond to him is the way he will respond to me, is what it's saying in this denial situation. And let's keep it in context. In this denial, because the strength of this denial, Jesus talked about it in Matthew. And in Matthew, he told the people back then, he said that if you will not confess me before men, I will not confess you before my Father. Again, how they responded to Jesus, you choose not to confess, you choose not to witness about me before men, if you choose not to tell anybody about me or tell anybody that you're saved, if you choose to hide your relationship with me, if you choose to deny me, not to witness, not to confess me before men, I will not confess you before the Father. And again, this is a mindset of someone that just says, I don't want Jesus. I'm not going to follow him. He's not the one. Even if he is, I'm still not following. I don't believe. Then you just shut yourself off. This is that classification of an unbeliever who's setting their course right to a place called hell, because God does not send anyone to hell, as we always know and teach. We send ourselves by not accepting him. And then number four, he said in verse number 13, last statement, he says, if we are faithless, guess what? He remains faithful. Why? Because he cannot deny himself. If we are faithless, this now he's talking about a believer. The denying is an unbeliever. Now he's talking about believer. If you are faithless, if we as believers fall short in our faithfulness to the Lord, that's what it means to be faithless. I fall short in my faithfulness to the Lord. His faithfulness to me is not contingent upon my faithfulness to him. Now we can close right now and everybody can just go to bed on that one right there. I mean, that is a powerful truth, that if we are faithless, he remains faithful. In other words, his faithfulness to me is not contingent upon my faithfulness to him. Somebody ought to throw your hands up and just tell him, thank you, Lord. You ought to just tell him, thank you, because immediately it ought to just raise up thoughts in your mind and in my mind of times when I fell short in the faithful category, times when I was not faithful to the Lord and I knew I was not faithful to him, but yet he still came through. Oh, I feel God's presence. He still opened doors. He still made a way. He still blessed. He still healed. He still restored. He still just did exactly what you needed him to do. And you knew you were faithless. You knew you were not standing the way you should have stood, but God still stood up for you. He still made sure you ended up on top. He still made sure you had more than enough. He still made sure you were covered. Somebody ought to be putting like crazy in that chat, thank you for your faithfulness. Thank you for your faithfulness. Thank you for, because some of, we don't have to go far back and remember when I was faithless, but still he woke you up. That's the faithfulness of God. Still he has clothes on your back. Still he has strength in your body. Still he continues to move and make a way and give you favor and his goodness and his mercy. Thank you, Lord, that your faithfulness to me is not contingent upon my faithfulness to you. But oh God, we want to be so much more faithful. But thank you that when we fall short, you're still there to keep us. You're still there to wash us. You're still there to bless us. Thank you for your, you cannot even deny yourself. That's what the text says, that he can't deny who he is. He is faithful. He is good. He can't stop being who he is, based upon my actions. And that's a great principle for you and I to pull right out of this text. Don't allow the actions of others to change who you are. Don't do it. Don't allow the actions of others to change you, who you are. You don't let somebody's craziness stop you from being a worshiper. Don't let somebody's craziness stop you from being one who praises and loves God and who walks obedience to Him. Don't let somebody else's unforgiveness stop you from forgiving. Don't let somebody else's sadness stop you from walking with joy. Don't let somebody's defeat stop you from walking in victory. You don't let nobody's actions change who you are. You and I are who we are by the grace of God, and we won't allow the actions of others to change that. Just how Christ doesn't allow my actions to change who He is. Then He says in verse number 14, He says, remind them, Timothy, remind them of these things, charging them before the Lord not to strive about words to no profit, to the ruin of the hearers. He says, Timothy, remind them of these things. He's talking about these right here, these four powerful statements that he said, these are faithful sayings. He said, Timothy, remind them of these things. Remind them of my faithfulness. Remind them that if they die with me, they will live with me. Remind them that if they endure, that they will reign with me. They will experience victory. Remind them if they deny me, you know, if anyone out there denies me, that unbeliever, then I will deny him. Remind them of these things. He tells them, remind, the word remind and the instruction to remind for a pastor, a teacher, the bulk of what we do is reminding people what they already know, yeah. Reminding them of what we already shared. The bulk of teaching, whether it is children, whether it is youth, whether it is adults, the bulk of our teaching is reminding what we already know, making sure that we just instill it in us and making sure that we never forget it and that we walk with it. And the truth is that even in the world of business, in the world of sports, it's most of the teaching, most of the practice, when they come back and huddle, it is a reminder. It is a reminder. They run the same plays in practice. They'll add some new ones, but trust me, they're going to do the same play every single week. They're going to come back with it. And then in practice, reminders. So because the more I get something in me and more I'm reminded of something, it stays in my heart and in my mind until it just becomes so easy for me to do that because I've been constantly reminded of it. So he told Timothy to remind him of these things. Yeah. Then he said, charging them before the Lord not to strive about words to no profit, to the ruin of the hearers. He's saying here, don't fight. Tell the people stop fighting over words and topics that profit no one. And I want all of us to be careful of that. And you'll know it if you get in a conversation, words or topic, and you know this is not going to profit anybody. Don't go any further. Get out of that, because he says the only thing it's going to do is going to ruin the ears of those who are listening to that conversation, and it will just damage them. So don't get in arguments, especially about things of faith or you know things that are Bible based. Don't fight and argue over those things. You know, whatever is true is always going to come to the light. Verse 15, he says, be diligent to present yourselves approved to God, a worker who does not need to be ashamed, rightly dividing the word of truth. Paul tells Timothy, be diligent to present yourself approved to God. The word diligent, he is commanding Timothy, and I love this command. He's saying, Timothy, work hard. Work hard to please God. I want you to put in that chat now, put in work. He's telling Timothy, work hard to please God. Christianity cannot be some little bicycle ride in a park on a nice day, just, you know, enjoying yourself. No, our walk with Christ, maturing and growing, that which we are after, P4W family, our desire is to mature and to grow. You got to work hard. You got to work hard. And I pray that we are convicted by this word, be diligent to present yourself. I pray that God will convict us tonight And then we'll ask ourselves, am I really working hard, or am I just kind of skating and just kind of just skipping along? Am I just kind of just casually walking and really just casually strolling in my journey with the Lord and just expecting maturity to just happen? No, you got to put in work. You got to put in work. You have to work hard in order to please God. It's not just going to happen. Work hard at prayer. Can I honestly say I work hard to make sure I'm praying twice a day? You know, I'm working hard to make sure I'm worshiping every day. I'm working hard to make sure that I am fasting once a week. You know, I'm going down the fit chart. I'm working hard to make sure I'm in fellowship. I'm working hard to make sure that I am doing the will of God. I'm working hard to make sure that I am the absolute best pastor that I can be. I'm working hard to make sure that I'm just walking in obedience and submitting to the Lord. I am working hard. This is not gonna happen just because I wake up and I'm a believer. I think that I'm going to grow and just mushroom into this strong Christian. You got to work hard. You got to work hard. Put in work. Put in work. Put in work. It's not going to happen. You cannot just skip your way into glory. You can't skip your way into being strong in Christ. You got to put in work. So can I say I am really working hard to be the strongest believer that I can be? And he said, work hard to please him. That's what it means to present yourself approved to God. Work hard to please him. Every day I'm presenting myself before God. Work hard to please him. Every day, work hard. I want you to be able to go to bed at night and say, I worked hard to please you. I worked hard to keep your word. And notice, it don't mean you're going to be perfect, but you know what? I'm working hard to do it exactly the way the Lord has instructed me to do it. I am working hard. When a worker, and then he says this, a worker who does not need to be ashamed, rightly dividing the word truth. In other words, a worker does not need to be ashamed. If you ain't working, you need to be ashamed. A worker can look back over their day and look back over the week and look back over this year, 2020, a worker, somebody who put in work, who worked hard, and not be ashamed. But if you haven't been working hard, there ought to be some shame in you, enough shame to say, that's it. I'm tired of just trying to skip my way along this walk as a believer. I'm going to put in work, and I'm going to see results. Because trust me, you don't put in work, you're not going to see any results. Rightly dividing the word of truth means accurately understanding the word, accurately making sure that the word of God, the way he wrote it, what he wants me to know, that I am dividing it accurately. I'm not adding to it. I'm not trying to, you know, put something in there that's not there accurately. And the Holy Spirit will help you and I accurately understand the word so that we can accurately live the word and accurately teach the word. He will do that if we apply ourselves. Then verse 16 and 18. We almost done. We stop at verse 19. 16 through 18, but shun profane and idle babblings, for they will increase to more ungodliness, and their message will spread like cancer. Hymenaeus and Philetus, him, are of this sort, who have strayed concerning the truth, saying that the resurrection is already past, and they overthrow the faith of some. To summarize verse 16 and 18, he's saying, stay away again. It was something bad then, and it happens now. Stay away from conversations that are not profitable. Stay away from conversations that lead to ungodly living. Such words will get in your mind and begin to consume your thoughts. And these two dudes, I just call them Hyman and Phil, them two dudes, they taught that the resurrection was just spiritual and not physical. They taught that the resurrection happened at conversion. They did not believe in the physical bodily resurrection, that Jesus rose and he was, you know, rose in his body. And then, of course, when after rising, you know, he went on to heaven. They don't believe in the physical resurrection. And they were teaching, and some believed them, and they were led astray, and they walked away from the faith. And even though they walked away from the faith, he said in the last verse, verse 19, nevertheless, the solid foundation of God stands, having this seal, the Lord knows those who are his. And let everyone who names the name of Christ depart from iniquity. Here Paul is saying, Timothy, no matter who leaves, no matter who walks away, no matter who turns from the faith, no matter how long they've been in, and then they turn and walk away, he says the foundation of God remains solid. Amen. The foundation of God, it stands. The foundation of the Lord does not shake and shiver when someone walks away. Paul told Timothy, no matter who walks away and leaves, the foundation of the Lord is solid and it stands. And Timothy knew, again, Paul is using an analogy like a building or like a temple. The foundation, it remains. It remains, he's telling. And he says this, having this seal, that part of having this seal, a seal was an inscription that reveals the truth about something. When they would put a seal upon something, it would be an inscription, a writing that spoke of authority or the truth about something. And here is the seal, the authority, and the truth that Paul said, Timothy, I want you to know these two things. And so if you can picture a building, a structure, and all these people are getting ready to walk through the door, and above the door is the seal, and the seal says this, the Lord knows those who are his. No matter how many are walking in that building, the seal says this, the Lord knows those who are his. So you can have thousands, millions, hundreds walking in the building, and all those walking in, that says the Lord knows those who are his. And then he says this, let everyone who names the name of Christ depart from iniquity. Those are the seals as you walk inside the temple, inside the body. The Lord knows those who are his. And then you let everyone who names the name of Christ depart from iniquity. In other words, if I claim to be one of his, he knows who those who are here. If I claim to be one of his, then I will fight to not live ungodly. I will fight to live holy. Amen. To depart from iniquity, I want you to see that as someone going to an airport and they said your plane is about to depart. And when you get on that plane departs where it was parked, whatever airport, it departs that city or that state and it leaves. That's what you and I do as it pertains to iniquity. You get on your flight and you leave. You depart. You fight to not live a life of iniquity. And that is all of us who name and claim Christ as my Lord and as my Savior. If I claim him, God already knows who's here, but if I claim him, you're not going to see me living in darkness and living in sin. Father, thank you for your word tonight. Thank you again, God, for speaking these words to Paul, who wrote them to Timothy. Put it in the word so that we can have it today, so that we can know those faithful sayings, God, that if we die with you, we will live with you, God. And I pray that we will master being dead and alive at the same time. God, I thank you for the word that you have given unto us tonight. God, if we endure, if we remain while we're going through, we remain with you, God. We live with you. We remain with you. We will triumph with you. For unbelievers, anyone who's listening tonight, you're not saved. If you deny him, if you stay in that position, you will be denied by him. And then lastly, those of us who are walking with him, if we know that if we are faithless, if we fall short, my God, he remains faithful. He cannot deny himself. God, I pray that you will seal this word in us tonight. Strengthen us. Bring it back to our remembrance so that, God, we can stand strong, mature, and grow and be built up in you. Nobody like you, God. And we thank you for your word in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Amen.